What we're seeing, unfortunately, all over the world is a rising number of human rights violations, and not just against individual activists or dissidents, but against populations and whole communities. And so the tools of population-based science are essential if we want to understand the impacts of human rights violations on the well-being of communities, populations, vulnerable groups at risk. In 2017, there was an enormous concentrated attack against the Rohingya people. That drove 700,000 people across the border into Bangladesh and created the world's largest refugee camp, but also led to an enormous number of survivors who had witnessed these atrocities. What we did with PHR was a systematic interview project of every surviving village leader from all of the communities that had been attacked. We did the back-end epidemiology collection, systematic data collection, data analysis, and scientific publication, because it's very important to get these kind of findings out into the peer-reviewed scientific literature, and that's a part of what we do.
We know that in wars, infectious disease spread, water systems are destroyed, clean water becomes impossible to get in many circumstances, kids don't get vaccinated, so we have to pay attention to health in these situations. It's really tragic that work that I did 10 years ago is becoming relevant now. What happened then was the Burmese army targeted healthcare workers who were trying to serve displaced populations in eastern Myanmar, and they were targeted because they were providing health care. And that's what's happening now. Health workers were leaders in the civil disobedience movement after the coup, and now are in hiding or have been arrested because they are targets of the regime.
We see globally that about 1 in 3 women worldwide experience intimate partner violence or sexual violence from a non-partner. That burden is actually disproportionately experienced by some of our most marginalized populations. Who are those groups? We're talking about youth, young people, particularly globally, but in the US as well, where premarital relationships are really shamed and silenced. And so the youth that are experiencing violence can experience added levels of shame and stigma. We also work with really economically marginalized populations, women that are trading sex, women that are homeless as a result of intimate partner violence. So those are some of our groups that are experiencing higher levels of abuse, and also are ones that we really need to lift up and invest to understand what are the determinants and really what works for prevention and response.
The study of transgender women in the US, it's actually one of many studies that we have in the center. This is the first and largest multi-site cohort that specifically focused on following transgender women to understand their unique health risks and HIV risks in the United States. The study itself was motivated by the fact that there is a very high burden of HIV among transgender women in the United States. And we were really interested in providing a study that focused on their unique risks. Our goal was also to understand the health risks and social issues that are important to the community. So we focus on also understanding and generating statistics around experiences of violence victimization, stigma and discrimination, access to healthcare and to gender-affirming services.
A fair bit of our work really pulls together human rights issues, HIV prevention and treatment, as well as implementation research. So for example, we work in Senegal where being gay is criminalized, but yet we really want to aim to serve folks with the prevention and treatment services that they need. The core of the work is really about working with government, working with police, working with community, and ensuring that the services that we are providing meet people's human rights needs in terms of like allowing them to live free lives and live healthily, but also make sure that in doing that, that they are protected from HIV, from sexually transmitted infections, and also serving people's mental health needs, their reproductive health needs in general.
I have worked for many years focusing on access to care for low-income immigrants, especially those who are undocumented. I've collaborated very closely with the Baltimore City Health Department, running their sexual health clinics, TB clinics. I also do a lot of work with community outreach workers. And so we do outreach in testing HIV, and also during COVID, thousands and thousands of COVID tests and vaccinations out in the community. And finally, I run for Johns Hopkins a charity care program called the Access Partnership, which provides access to care here at Hopkins for low-income, uninsurable individuals, which primarily means undocumented individuals. And we serve over 1,600 patients a year.
Doing this kind of work, this public health and human rights work, where both rights violations and the health of populations is threatened, is enormously challenging work. I'm incredibly proud of our faculty and staff and students who engage in this work. It is not easy, and unfortunately in our world, what we are seeing is that there are more and more of these health and human rights interactions happening. And we really feel that it's essential for scientists and public health people to be there and to participate in trying to prevent these abuses and mitigate their effects.